Alrighty, hello again, everyone, and welcome to it. It's the Daily Caller Podcast for Friday, February 7th, 2020. I'm Derek Hunter. I'm your host. Welcome to the program. It's the Friday interview edition, as we always do, and we like to bring people who are in more successful positions than we are. And this one just happens to be down the hall. Not really, because he works remotely, but he works for us here at the Daily Caller, the Daily Caller News Foundation. It is Peter Hassan. Welcome to the program, Peter.
Thank you for having me, Derek.
You're not here just because we want to pick your brain for no good reason, and you're not selling some wolf book. You have a new book out called The Manipulators, Facebook, Google, Twitter, and Big Tech's War on Conservatives, just out Tuesday, available everywhere. Go get it now. Before we get into the content of the book, there's a question I like to ask anybody who writes a book, is why? What was it that caused you to go, I can't just do this in an op-ed. I can't do this in a piece. This is going to require more. And there had to be a moment where you're like, oh my God, this is a real deal thing. What was it for you? What was that light on moment?
And that's actually a great question, because I did have kind of one of those moments. And it was especially right after the 2016 election, where you saw this freak out about these fake news pages that studies later showed had no impact.
Right, $10,000 from Russia. If Russia's that efficient, let's turn over our government to them. We can do that for 10 grand. Let's give it all of them.
Exactly. But I saw that as being something kind of as part of a larger trend, which was all these liberal establishment outlets and voices were really wanting to take back these massive platforms, Facebook, Google, Twitter, that conservatives had used to really escape the bubble that they're a part of. And so really, to me, when the light bulb kind of clicked on was when, after the 2016 election, all of a sudden, everybody decided that Facebook had to change, Google had to change, Twitter had to change, YouTube had to change. And that was because they didn't like that conservatives were able to kind of get around
but
the bubble.
They weren't oases for conservatives beforehand either. That's what's kind of funny about it is, conservatives worked within the framework of liberalism that they'd set up and found a way to make it work. And then suddenly that's not good enough.
Exactly. It just the fact that it wasn't biased enough and that it wasn't slanted enough was you know, unacceptable. And then so over the last 4 years, now I say it's like the biggest untold story of the Trump era is how these platforms have changed to being, you know, if not, you know, totally even, you know, even as to now, they're explicitly tiered platforms that are boosting certain outlets and certain voices and suppressing other voices and other outlets.
And they're unambiguous about it. YouTube, Google, Alphabet, whatever you want to call it, after the 2016 election, had a big tearful all-staff meeting where they're like, oh, I can't believe this. And it wasn't just somebody in the mailroom sitting there crying. These were the executives on stage in front of the entire staff saying, we're as shocked as you are, we're as disappointed as you are, and breaking down and crying about that. Companies used to try and say, we're not interested in politics. It's different when it's a media company online. But to see that as somebody who follows this, who reports on this and wrote a book on this, when you saw that video for the first time, what was going through your head?
Well, I mean, to be honest, it was confirmation of what the right had already suspected, which is that people inside Google were all rooting against Trump. And then, but to me, the biggest takeaway from that video was the fact that the people in Google, their reaction was, how do we stop this from happening again? As if it's their responsibility to control who wins elections and who doesn't. And that really was the reaction across, you know, all of big tech was, we don't like that this happened. What can we do to make sure it doesn't happen again? And that's what's been happening over the past 4 years, is this, you know, just steady transformation of these platforms that really slant the public discussion in certain ways and always against conservatives.
Who made the first move after 2016 to correct, quote unquote, the injustice of people voting their conscience?
Well, really, it was kind of a flood just all at once, you know. And Facebook, for example, decided immediately after the 2016 election that that's when they needed to care about fake news. Mm-hmm. And of course, these studies have come out. There was one from the University of Michigan and Princeton that showed fake news had literally no impact Which, of course, the people who believe fake news are the people who want to believe fake news. They aren't the swing voters.
And you, if you're seeking out outrageous headlines, you're already, your mind's made up.
Exactly. It's not like pushing you from one side to the other.
I think Hillary Clinton's a nice person. Wait a second. She kills puppies? Oh, my God, I can't vote. There's nobody out there like that.
Exactly. But really what it was is it was a big Trojan horse to really give them cover for changing how their platforms work from being, you know, that the influence of your from where it was once that your the influence of your page was how many people followed you, how many people shared your content, and what just choices people made. Whereas now it's are you what Facebook deems an authoritative source? Are you in their Facebook news program, which only certain outlets do? Are you paid for their Facebook news program, which a very even smaller number of outlets are? And so now it's just become this whole tiered system where the people who always win happens to be their favorites, the CNNs, the Washington
Post. Talk about how the impact that has had on conservative media. There were websites in 2016, conservative websites, IJ Review comes to mind, that were just wildly, explosively popular on social media. Facebook shares, it wasn't uncommon to see 100,000 Facebook shares of their posts. And then Facebook tweaks its algorithm. They decide to move the goal line a little bit. And they're collapsing.
Exactly. No, and that honestly was one of the biggest changes that they made in early 2018, and it really neutered not just IJR, which it did. IJR was they were massive.
They co-sponsored one of the presidential primary debates in 2016. They were that big.
Yeah, and then they were the first to report that Gorsuch was going to be the nominee. Like they were a big outlet. They were making moves. That Facebook tweaks its algorithm, and all of a sudden. That they're gone. They're nothing. I mean, they're a non-player. If it you know. And then there was another outlet too, Rare, which was kind of this libertarian, and the same thing. The algorithm just neutered them. And it's interesting if this was happening to bigger outlets on the right.
Is there any correlating liberal website? Did Huffington Post see a decrease in traffic?
Like Huffington Post didn't
daily costs or anything.
Yeah, they didn't go out of business. You know, and so it's and what the studies have shown, there's one by NewsWhip, which is widely respected. They're not partisan. They found Facebook's algorithm changes benefited the corporate establishment liberal media, and they hurt the alternative political companies, which in essence turning Facebook from something that was once outlet for people to get, around the bubble, to escape the bubble, to just reinforcing the bubble.
Explain what you mean, though, as far as Facebook changing its algorithm, because most people think, well, I like the Daily Caller, therefore Daily Caller stuff will show up in my time. I don't have to go to the Daily Caller website. The reason you like a page is so the news comes to you, so you don't have to go to that page every day. You go to your homepage and there's your timeline. And it's supposed to be populated with the people that you know and the news that you want. But that's not really what's going on.
No, I mean, it's definitely not anymore. It's something where it's, maybe you'll have your favorite website pop up once out of 10 times. Like, oh, well, it's popping up. But the other 9 times, it's buried it from you. And something that I talk about in the book is these tech companies don't need to delete content to censor content. Mm-hmm. You can bury something down your feed and make sure you'll never see it. And just because they aren't deleting it doesn't mean you can't see it. So if Google pushes something to the fourth page of results, barely anybody's going to see it.
Right.
And so they're censoring it without deleting it. And that's what we've seen on Facebook a lot, is they're still, allowing some in this. I mean, they were deleting some stuff, but they're still allowing conservatives to have a voice, but they're just making it harder and harder and harder. And they're just slanting the platform to now, if you're a voice on the right, you're fighting an uphill battle. If you're a voice on the left, you have an easy downhill jog.
Most people don't realize how important Facebook is to websites. Talk a little bit about how it became that powerful and what that power actually is, because some websites, like you said, IJ Review, you see an 80% drop in traffic and you haven't been banned. You haven't published, pictures of people murdering people or anything like that. Just suddenly, one day, it's gone. Traffic from Facebook, much more so than Twitter, is an enormous part of everybody's business model in this space.
Yeah, yeah, and you know, and it's because it's one of those things where it really comes to you. But especially for conservatives, it was a massive, or for outlets on the right, it was a massive, massively important tool because it allowed you to find people who thought the same way that you thought, and allowed you to really reach the people who the corporate liberal establishment media were just ignoring. Mm-hmm. And so where they all have this bubble, you know, where they're all saying the same thing. Everyone saw it in 2016. All CNN, Washington Post, New York Times, they all had the same narrative. And what Facebook did is it allowed people to escape the narrative. And it's up to the people who use Facebook. They were choosing to escape the bubble. And that's what these corporate companies don't like, is that people are choosing outlets other than them. And it's their fault because they lost people's trust. But now, you know, now that they've demanded that these tech companies overhaul their platforms to give them an advantage. And so really they're kind of taking this thing that was a tool for people to kind of get around them, and they're just saying, actually, we have an inherent right to those views, and they're you know, like prima nocta, like it's
you don't get a Braveheart reference. All that you know, it's Facebook is one thing. Facebook has actually seemingly they're at least playing nicer with conservatives. You've got Zuckerberg coming out. He has the big powwow with right-wing media, and he met with the president and the left, tried to crucify him for that. They're at least acknowledging that there's something they have to address. And it may be explicit. I assume it's mostly explicit, but some of it is just inherent in who they hire and where they work. Google, on the other hand, is explicit in the other direction. They don't give a damn. Mm-hmm. They're the biggest kid in town. They control YouTube, which is a gigantic platform. It is the platform. There are others out there, but they don't really register. And we're seeing conservatives, Scott Adams, who puts out videos, commentary. He does the Dilbert comic strip. I don't even know if Dilbert still made, or he did Dilbert. Whatever. Yeah. He's got Dilbert money. I could use some Dilbert.
The Dilbert guy, yeah.
Yeah. He puts out these video commentaries that aren't particularly explicitly conservative or partisan or anything like that. But he's even finding that they're immediately demonetized. Mm-hmm. Then 12 to 24 hours later, after he says, what the hell is going on? Why is it? What's so offensive about this? And Google says, oh, our bad. Sorry. 80% of his traffic, therefore 80% of the potential revenue is gone. This is happening to David Rubin or the Rubin Report. This is happening across the board to conservatives. While Facebook is extending occasional olive branches. They might whap you in the face with it, but they at least are extending the olive branch.
Or paying lip service.
Right. Is there any similar acknowledgement from Alphabet, from Google?
No, absolutely not. And you know, as you're saying, at least Facebook, and you know, they are biased. They've done a lot of things that really harm conservatives. But at least they're paying lip service to the problem, if not actually addressing it. Google is just the opposite. Google is just sprinting the other direction to where they're really becoming less of a search engine to find what you're looking for and more a search engine to find the New York Times, the Washington Post, CNN, and these other outlets that they've decided
nobody else
will always get the top spot. And you know, like a minuscule fraction of people even click past the first page. And so they're really, and you know, what's interesting is I obtained documents that showed in the aftermath of the election, you know, Google employees talking about how can we, you know, keep this from happening. One of their solutions was to bury alternative outlets in search results. You know, they eventually decided, well, maybe not explicitly, but we can find, you know, but they can find ways to accomplish that without. And so even just saying authoritative sources, you know, we'll boost authoritative sources, which means CNN, the New York Times, Washington Post, all these liberal establishment outlets. And then say, oh, we're not targeting conservatives. Right. We're just boosting authoritative.
Exactly.
It's
the cream rises to the top. Well, sometimes shit floats too.
Yeah, exactly.
It just depends on what you put into the toilet and what goes on in the toilet. Twitter, on the other hand, shadow banning. They are infamous for shadow banning, something they occasionally admit, but also express a passionate indifference towards doing anything about. I personally am shadow banned for the past 5 months, I have been stuck exactly at 51,900 followers, no matter what. Every month prior to that, I was gaining hundreds and thousands of followers. I was getting millions of impressions, and then suddenly it all flatlined and went down. I have no idea what I did. I didn't get a notification that said, you shouldn't have tweeted that story, you need to delete mm-hmm. that, or anything like that. My case is not the most egregious. People are simply banned for thinking wrong. But Jack Dorsey, again, seems to be paying lip service. But unlike Zuckerberg at Facebook, his lip service seems less sincere to me. Mm-hmm. Am I wrong in thinking
not
that?
Not at all. You know, Jack Dorsey is kind of the platonic ideal of the Silicon Valley progressive. You know, mm-hmm. he apologizes for eating at Chick-fil-A. He, you know, goes on these, you know, spiritual awakenings to Hindu villages. And but no, yeah, he's very much insincere. Jack Dorsey cares about Jack Dorsey. And really Twitter, and one of the interesting things about Twitter, and one of the ways Twitter has changed, is that they're really turned to a liberal news company. You know, they put out, hiring ads, you know, and they said, we're looking to hire journalists. And what they're doing then is with Twitter Moments, Twitter Trending Topics, all these, I mean, they're basically just hiring journalists, without bylines, without
right.
any accountability or transparency, then to just write news on their site and keep people there, which again, is basically turning from where it was this open platform, you know, whoever gets the most views, most followers wins, to we're going to pick and choose which things you see at the top of the
feed. I want to follow you mm-hmm. because I want to know what you're tweeting. Now it's you're following them, but you probably didn't. You might not have meant that.
Yeah.
We'll give you some of their tweets, but mm-hmm. we're not going to give you all of them. And we're going to throw in some other random things that we think you should be looking at.
And there's no transparency either. And so everyone's completely blind to what's going on behind the curtain. And so it's really one of these things where it's just, you know, the term gaslighting is overused, but this is gaslighting where they're just saying, you know, nothing's changing as they keep moving the line in and in and in. But then especially the fact that they have these, you know, these unnamed journalists, of course, are liberal and whatnot, you know, basically choosing what Twitter Moments are going to be and whatnot, it really reinforces the bias. So if you look at the Covington Catholic episode, Twitter amplified the smear of the Covington Catholic kids because they did a Twitter moment and saying, mm-hmm. look at what these terrible, you know, white private school kids in MAGA hats did to this poor old man.
This noble Native American veteran.
Yeah. And they helped blow it up. And then, of course, when it fell apart, that didn't get its own Twitter moment. And so they're really just becoming an arm of the liberal establishment media. That originally that there were a way for people to escape that. You know, if you look at the Kermit Gosnell case, that was something where the media wasn't covering the court case, which had horrific, right. horrific, you know, details.
Country's most prolific serial killer.
Exactly, which, you know, should be catnip to media, you know, and they're, you know, firsthand accounts of him, you know, snipping babies, you know, spines and saying, oh, this baby is about to walk me out of here before I, you know, kill it. Really should have been catnip for the media. They didn't cover it. The courtroom was completely empty until conservatives on Twitter, especially Molly Hemingway, and I'm blanking on the other guy's name, who's
Fallon McAleer or
Mulaney or someone.
Doesn't matter.
Anyway, but this conservative pro-life blogger who was in the courtroom and tweeted out this photo, like, there's no media here except me. And it blew up into this thing. And finally, the media were shamed into covering it. And that was the power that Twitter gave conservatives. It was a way to do the media's job for them and to really embarrass them for not covering something, to force them to cover it.
But that's why it had to be destroyed.
Exactly. And that's why Twitter then had to be turned into an extension of that same media. Because God forbid people be allowed to think for themselves.
It is interesting. If you look at the trending topics on the right-hand side of the page, there's always, you know, something massive, and it has, sometimes they have the number of tweets, 176,000 tweets about this, and then number two is Donald Trump sucks, 3,200 tweets, and then number three has another 50,000 tweets. Like, how is that number two? How does that work? Then trending topics, they don't mean anything. It's somebody's mm-hmm. behind the scenes deciding this needs attention.
Yeah, I mean, like, anybody who's been watching it can see that it gives off the appearance of being much more curated now. Almost kind of, you know, and it bears resemblance to, you know, the old school Facebook trending topics, which that you know, there was that whole scandal where these employees admitted we're picking and choosing which rise to the top of the trending topics and which doesn't. As Twitter is following that same kind of path, it's not surprising that it's kind of the same thing. Like, you know, 1,000 people tweeted about this, it's trending. 100,000 people tweeted about this, we don't like those people, it's not trending.
Do we know? It's theoretical because nobody was looking, and there was so little money in 2016. But do we know that the amount of impact they could have, that this could have? There's no doubt that it hurts conservative businesses. It hurts conservative news sites. And if there's a protest that the left-wing mob decides to go after a company, that can hurt that company because they'll elevate that. But as far as electoral politics go, do we have data on that, or is it speculation?
Yeah, in fact, oh my goodness, I'm blanking on this guy's name. The guy who studied the effect of the Google search results. His wife died in a car crash. I'm trying to remember his name.
Liberal professor.
His
name is less relevant than the results.
So anyway, this left of center professor, an expert at this kind of thing, studied basically how Google search results can massively skew an election, whether intentionally or unintentionally. And it can. He posited that it's affecting elections all over the world. And what's particularly scary about that is that Google employees are embracing the fact that they should be affecting elections. So not only do they have the power to do so, we now, as his studies have shown, we now know that they really, really, really want to. And on top of that, it's because there is no transparency. You just have to take their word for it. And so it's a really, really disturbing phenomenon. That really should give a lot of people pause. Even encourage them to use other search engines, even just to double check. Yeah.
Now, these companies exist and haven't been sued out of existence because they exist in this place where they're essentially a kiosk. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't get pissed off at the poster board that the band looking for the new bass players is stapled to. If it's your old band and you got kicked out of that band, it's just a kiosk. It's just sitting there. So they have enjoyed a sense of immunity from the content that they have. Do they actually fear losing that? Is there that big of a fear? Because it doesn't seem to be impacting the threats of losing that immunity don't seem to be impacting their behavior at all, which tells me that they either don't consider the threat serious that it'll ever happen, or they don't care. Like Google, we got more money than God. We'll just throw $1 million at every lawsuit. Yeah. We won't even notice it.
Yeah, no, and so it's definitely something where they definitely don't fear it from the right. You know, I think a lot of that is due in part to, you know, people on the right have kind of a hesitancy to use government power. And so I don't think they're really worried that people on the right are actually going to follow through on threats to bring government force to this. But what I can see them being concerned about is people on the left who are very willing to abuse government power. And you look at Elizabeth Warren saying,
she's got a bug up her butt about that.
It is. It's insane. But and so it's just, and so people on the left clearly want the government to be penalizing misinformation. And even if you
choose, as long as they get to choose what the information is.
But misinformation being defined as news that doesn't help the left.
Right.
And so it really is something where, you know, where they can either try to get ahead of it and just say, okay, your people are going to win on the platform, we're cool, or they might actually have to deal with Elizabeth Warren trying to penalize misinformation, like China, you know?
Every once in a while, the president will talk about this. There will be Republicans who talk about this, but you're right. They don't do it. It's not in their DNA to immediately say we need to regulate these sorts of things. But is there a point that you reach a tipping point where it's too late to regulate them? And you can't pull up from the nosedive? Is there? I'm naturally anti-regulation, but these companies are monopolies in their chosen field. And it's not just in the service or search engine or the social media platforms. It's in ad revenue. That's the money that they're controlling is enormous and monopolistic. That's where my problem
is. It really is.
Two minds.
Yeah, and I think, you know, that the angle there is especially the antitrust angle, because especially, you know, you look at these companies where they're both kind of the poster board, but also the person posting on the poster board, and they give their own products top billing, you know, and they're really, really not being transparent. So one thing Google's doing right now, actually, which skews their search results towards companies with money and outlets with money, is they're basically, they've changed the way they present ads. And so it used to be ads, like Google ads in the search results had this bright yellow box that said ads. Right. Everybody knew it was an ad. And now
they look like normal search results, just underneath the URL. Tiny little asterisk ad.
Yeah, exactly. And so, which really now it's becoming a pay for play enterprise. You want the search, the top search result, you can pay for it. Who does that benefit? That benefits establishment voices.
It used to be, you know, Sears and Roebuck dominated the countryside. Mm-hmm. Department stores were huge. Kmart was a giant corporation. Now they've all gone the way of the dodo. Is tech inherently different than brick and mortar as far as the ability to ward off new competitors? Yeah, you remember Friendster existed, mm-hmm. and then MySpace was big, and then Facebook took over. But Facebook, its lifespan is much longer than any of the others. Google has become ubiquitous. It's now, it's a verb. It is, you know, like Q-tip. It's the brand. It's Kleenex of search. Is there a way to overcome that naturally, or does government have to have a hand on the scale?
Honestly, one thing I can see where the scales could kind of change a bit is if people really start to lose trust in them. And what's going to make people lose trust in them is if they educate themselves on how these platforms are abused.
Unfortunately, they'll go to these platforms to try and look up how they're being screwed
over. You'll ask Google if Google's screwing you over. not to plug the book, but plug the book, and you'll understand why you shouldn't trust Google. But it really is, because Google depends a lot on people trusting Google to not be playing with their search results. That's why people don't click past the first page, because they assume all the good stuff is right here. I think where the problem for Google is, if they really keep doing this, where you can't trust what Google's giving you, it's the whole point of Google is gone. And so I think that's where there really is potential for them to go too far, is if they keep on the path that they're going, they're going to lose people's trust. And if people can't trust them, what's the value of Google?
But
it's just a guy in the street saying, hey, here's the answer to this.
Is everybody really going to migrate to Bing, though?
Probably, you know, it's tough to see, but, you know, it's always, you know.
It could happen.
Yeah.
You know, it would be nice if it
could
happened.
Be one of those things where 5 years, like, wow, I didn't see that coming. A duck goes. They're really, you know.
<It could.
laughs>
On the social media front, we could, and stay with me here for a second, it'd be crazy. But we could actually talk to human beings on the phone and in real life again.
Yeah, yeah. You know, like, God forbid.
Yeah, that'll never happen.
God forbid human interaction.
All right, Peter, as I ask everybody who writes a book too, when you set out to write this, you knew what you were going to write. You had an idea, you know, you had an outline in your head. You start doing the research. You start putting meat on the bones. What did you learn that shocked you the most, that you didn't know? You thought, you think, I got a handle on this. Mm-hmm. I can write a book about it. I'm going to write a book about it. And then in the middle of doing it, was it, holy crap, this is way worse than I thought, or this one's actually better than I thought? Like, what was it that surprised you in writing this?
Yeah, honestly, like, the scale of the problem is what really, really surprised me. I went in knowing that these companies leaned left. You know, their ideological makeup is really very similar to, you know, college campuses now, where you have the same SJWs, the same people complain about microaggressions.
It's not uncommon to hear, like, employees bitching in all staff emails about their bosses. And like, that should get you fired.
Yeah.
But no,
because now you're a victim. I kind of knew that going, but what really shocked me was just seeing the scale of the problem and seeing how willing these people are to really apply the massive power at their fingertips towards their ideological goals and towards their intersectional grievances.
Do they know they're cheating, or do they think they're doing justice?
Well, you know, it's not cheating if your side's on the right side of history.
Right,
you
know, they can justify it.
Yeah,
by that.
So it's just this really alternate reality that's not reality based. You know, you have obtained documents of these Google employees freaking out over the word family being used at a meeting. And they, because it was so offensive, someone said, well, family means kids, and I don't have kids. And another person said, my family is me and these other trans feminine people who all live in a house. That's my family. And these are the people whose product you trust to tell you what a family is.
As they close this book after reading The Manipulators, what is the thought that you want the reader to have as they drift off at night and sleep? Or will they close it and go, I'm not going to sleep tonight. I'm going to delete everything. I'm unplugging Siri. I'm unplugging Alexa. I'm going to throw everything in the garbage. I'm going to set up an EMP in the basement so there's nothing working here. I'm going to be a Luddite forever. What do you want?
I mean, that's kind of my retirement dream. Just go be the guy in the cabin.
Exactly. What do you want the lasting impression to be?
So I want the lasting impression to be really just a skepticism of what you see, because you can't take anything you see on social media at face value. But also you should come out with it knowing that this is really just a massive information battle, and you should come out wanting to support the people who are on your side, because right now there's nobody in the middle. And Google and Facebook and Twitter and YouTube they've chosen a side.
Right.
And so people really need to embrace this and support the voices and outlets on your side, because that's really your only chance of really having someone speak for you.
Of the three, Google, Facebook, and Twitter, which one stands the best chance, you think, of actually pumping the brakes and doing the right thing, or is there any of them?
Yeah, I don't know if there's any of them, really. I'd say maybe Facebook, but really doubt. I don't think any of them are going to pump the brakes.
Certainly not voluntarily.
Yeah, yeah. And so I think it's really a matter of who's going to the left fastest, and it's really just a race to the bottom.
The book, that's a charming thought. The book, The Manipulators, Facebook, Google, Twitter, and Big Tech's War on Conservatives, just out this Tuesday, available now. Peter Hassan is the author. Congratulations on the book. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you very much for having me.
Best of luck.
I appreciate it.
That's all the time we have. Go out and talk to real people in real life. You know, pick up the phone and use it as a phone for once. It does. You can talk to people through that, I swear to God. And be back here on Monday. Have a great weekend.